US Highland White Terrier, commonly known as Westie, is one of today's most popular breeds all around the world. Since the beginning of the 90s, the Westie has conquered the heart of many a dog lover by his alert and self-reliant yet friendly character, but above all because of his appealing appearance. To show the true beauty of a Westie to full advantage, as is done by these Westie ladies on the occasion of a dog show, he needs breed-specific care, namely the correct grooming. To show the right way how to do this yourself is the aim of this video. A good and qualified trimming requires the right tools, of course. You will be needing a terrier trimming brush, medium size, a comb with a handle, medium size, a canine guillotine clipper, a short-toothed stripping knife for the top coat, a pair of short hair scissors, a pair of long hair scissors, a pair of both side-toothed thinning scissors, and a long-toothed stripping knife for the undercoat. Now the trimming tools in detail. The short-toothed stripping knife for the top coat of a Westie. The toothing should be thin and have 2 mm length. The blade has to be blunt to avoid cutting the top coat instead of plucking it. To pluck the top coat correctly, the hair should be laying between thumb and blade. The hair tips. The hair middle, at the blade's edge. The roots. If the stripping knife is too sharp, it's all too easy to cut the hair instead of plucking it. Between thumb and blade, there are only the hair tips. On the blade's edge, the hair is cut in the middle. During trimming, you have to control constantly that you never cut the hair, as is demonstrated on the video. Please remember, never like that. As a second stripping knife, you will need a long-toothed thin undercoat knife. The 4-5 mm long teeth pierce through the top coat during trimming and take hold of the undercoat. This knife is essential for woolly dogs and Westies with an especially thick and quickly growing undercoat. Never use this knife for Westies with fine hair or little undercoat, as you would risk injuring the dog's skin with the long teeth. And again, the two types of hair together with their specific stripping knives in comparison. On the right side, the undercoat with the long-toothed stripping knife. On the left side, the top coat, for which a short-toothed stripping knife is used. The result of correct trimming is always the removal of the complete hair, from tip to root. The same applies to the woolly hair. Your scissors equipment should contain a pair of thinning scissors with 30 teeth of about 16 centimeters. A pair of long straight hair scissors of about 16.5 centimeters with a single blade micro toothing. A pair of short hair scissors of about 14 centimeters also with a single blade micro toothing. A canine guillotine clipper, a medium thin comb with a handle, and a medium-sized terrier plucking brush. Before you start trimming, the Westie needs a good brushing. You brush with and against the direction of the hair growth. The legs need a thorough brushing, especially at the inside. Brushes the hair on the head, first backwards, and then back to the front. Don't forget to reward your dog with a biscuit in between to keep him going. After brushing, you work your way through the coat with a comb to make sure to remove even the last mat. The comb has to glide over the skin. Only like that you can reach the mat at the roots. Leftover mat would be very much in the way during the trimming. By using chalk, the coat is easier to handle. Here, a chalk block is used, but loose chalk works likewise. And don't forget the biscuit. coat is combed along the natural direction of the growth of hair, because only like that it is guaranteed that the coat is trimmed in the right angle. This is very important for the blending from the head to the neck coat. With the help of this leash, this is demonstrated. Our Westie is now ready for the actual trim. First step is to find out which area needs plucking. So you comb a parting on the back and comb one hair part up, vertically. Now it is possible to see whether your Westie has different lengths of hair within the top coat. On our model, you can distinguish three different lengths. To make it clear which hair layer needs plucking, we have already plucked some centimeters of the oldest and longest top coat layer, so that you can see clearly the remaining new length of the top coat. The outer hair layer is the old top coat that needs plucking. In the middle, you can easily see the second length of the top coat, which gives a new length measure. Right above the parting, you see the very thick undercoat, where already the next still short top coat layer can be spotted. And once again, to avoid any confusion, in the middle, the new top coat, which gives the length down to which trimming is wanted, on the outside, the old mature top coat. To separate the old top coat from the new one, you brush it up against the natural growth of the hair. That way you can easily take hold of the hair ends and pluck them out. Plucking ought to be done only with your fingers, or if that seems to be straining, with a short-toothed stripping knife. Take only a few strands of hair at its tips between your thumb and the toothed blade edge. After plucking, there has to be the complete hair strand with the roots on the stripping knife. With your free hand, you don't stop loosening up the top coat against its natural growth, so that you can really grip only a few of the outer hair tips. The movement comes out of the arm and not out of the wrist, as otherwise your hand would tire much too soon. You should never grasp too deep into the coat, as you would grasp not only too many hairs, but also the firmly rooted hair. This would cost too much energy and is very uncomfortable for your dog. You move the hand as in calming and grasp very lightly with only just enough pressure to pluck the hair easily. Remember to keep on loosening up the coat, as that makes trimming so much easier. Plucking with your fingers is much more accurate than with a stripping knife, and you avoid damaging the hair in any way, as it is easily done when using the stripping knife incorrectly. With your thumb and index finger, you take a few hair tips and pluck them out with a quick pull. To support elastic skin, you should take hold of the neighboring hair strand with your free hand. In variation, you can also rest the palm of the hand you pluck with on the body of your dog. You should work with fast, light grips over not too small an area to avoid plucking a hole into the coat. Maybe some of the viewers are a bit confused that the trimming demonstration in this video starts at the back and not, as is recommended in many books, at the neck. Both ways are okay, and it is entirely up to you where you start from. In the shown case, trimming from back to front is preferred. It has the advantage that the hair tips of the untrimmed area stand out into the already trimmed section and are thereby easier to grip. From the croup, you pluck your way down the thighs and via the back down the chest. Let us watch our grooming lady more closely. How much further trimming is wanted for the side coat, you grip into the belly coat and brush the left out hair to the back. The same procedure goes for the leg hair. All the hair that can be brushed to the back needs plucking. If you would not do anything about it, it would stand out with every movement and blow about. If the top coat is of the required standard hard quality, you should use only a thin, short-toothed stripping knife. The stripping knife used in this video has been specially developed with the friendly assistance of the family Hauptner for the specific use on hard-coated terriers. Has to be thinned out thoroughly and to be plucked as short as possible. On the rear thighs, down to the stifle, you have to watch out for the right length of the hair to achieve an even blending of the back coat with the hair under the tail. Short trimmed areas, Westies with an extra thick undercoat need to have it thinned out with a long toothed stripping knife. But take care not to overdo this, as the idea is to get a predominating top coat. On the right the top coat, on the left the undercoat. On the left you see the already trimmed area, the right side is still untouched. Again, it is checked how much further plucking is required. The combed hair will be removed shortly. It is best to work over the blendings with your fingers. On the hind legs, no skirts should be left. The tail. Again, the overgrown hair is brushed up. And plucked out. A trimmed tail has much more volume and is easier to be shaped into the typical carrot shape. You should begin trimming the tail during your dog's puppy time already. It will look somewhat thinnish in the beginning, but in the long run it's worth the effort. On the back of the tail there is a gland. Here you have to be especially careful not to overdo the plucking, as the hair growth tends to be less active around this area than elsewhere. If the tail of a Westie has been cut so far, the hair wants thinning with the stripping knife first. The tail coat will develop from trimming session to trimming session, so you can pluck more hair accordingly. The tail is fairly broad at the bottom and tapers off to the tip. Mm-hmm. The bottom of the tail has more of an undercoat, which needs additional plucking with the undercoat stripping knife. It is difficult to get the tip of the tail into a well-groomed shape only by plucking. Here you may use the short scissors, as it is easier to handle in this particular case. As the tail should be as short as possible, the hair at the tip of the tail should only have a few millimeters length. To avoid cutting the dog, you press your thumbnail on the top of the tail and cut off the hair just above it. You brush the hair on the underside of the tail away from it. Cut it with the long scissors as short as possible, from bottom to top. Around the anus, the hair obviously has to be kept very short. With the scissors, the tail gets its finishing touch. You keep on spreading the hair off the tail to avoid missing overlong hairs and to give the tail its harmonic shape. Dog and the blending to the tail needs working over with the thinning scissors. Start cutting the paws, you have to make sure that the toenails are short enough. For the correct trimming of the paw, you form a circle around them with your hand and brush a coat over your fingers. You put the scissors horizontally on the dog's pads and your fingers. Like that, you avoid cutting the hair too short. And please remember to hold the scissors horizontally only, never vertically. Between the pads, you have to remove all hair as best as possible. If you press your thumb down on the pads, they spread, and it is easier to get at those inner hairs. For the paws, the short scissors are used. Leave the hair at the heels long and do the blending when the dog stands. The same applies to the paws, where you should correct the cut when the dog is standing. Sticking out hairs on the legs have to be plucked. Be careful with dogs with a thin leg coat. You cut along the contours of the stifle. Here you have to pay special attention to the inner thighs. have to look like little pillars. The rear view should give the impression of an upturned U. It looks rather disharmonic if you cut the paws as short as a poodle's. The nails have to be covered with hair at all times and end a few millimeters above the ground. The hair at the hock shouldn't be too short either, as otherwise you're likely to get an impression of weak and steep hindquarters. Let's carry on with the neck and shoulders. The coat on neck and shoulder should have a length of about 3-4 centimeters to get a flowing top line. On the shoulders and along the sides of the neck, the hair is plucked as short as 1-2 centimeters. Now the undercoat needs thinning. The leash demonstrates how far up the neck trimming is required. Chest too can be trimmed easily with the help of the stripping knife. The chest coat is trimmed downwards to the beginning of the front legs. Slanting down from the breastbone to the beginning of the front legs, the hair should resemble an apron. Thank you. front paws are cut like the hind paws, preferably with the short scissors. The hair is cut only around the nails. The hair at the rear of the paws remains untouched. Untidy or sticking out hairs of the front legs have to be plucked out. Cut along the contours of the paws so that the nails are almost invisible. With the long scissors, you model the front leg like a pillar. the elbow, the hair has to be trimmed very short, as otherwise the elbow would look slightly overstretched. For a neat blending, use a thinning scissors. Now to the trademark of a Westie, the head. If you have a Westie with two different hair lengths on the ears, a long top coat and a short undercoat, you have to pluck it to get a harmonic all over picture. But you have to take care to pluck only the long hair and not to damage the short coat. When you look at the Westie from the front, one third of the visible ear rim has to be trimmed off. If you bend the ear over your index finger and hold on tight with your thumb and middle finger, the hair behind the ear is easier to pluck. The long hair on the head gets either trimmed all around the head with your short-toothed stripping knife, or you can use your fingers. In case your Westie has a thick head coat, you can trim it down to the length of the new head coat, if it is not notably shorter than 2/3 of the ear. If the head coat is rather thin, you thin it a little further by plucking and cut it with the thinning scissors down to the length of 1/3 under the plucked ear tip. To achieve this, you comb the hair radially from the mid-head outwards over the ears. You hold the free hand behind the dog's head and press it against the air while calming. That way you ensure that all hair gets well combed. To avoid the hair slipping away during the cut, you hold it tightly just under the cutting line. First, you thin out the outer hair rim and cut gradually shorter towards the middle of the face. And a brush, you move the hair constantly into the wanted direction. And again, the outer rim of the head coat is cut first. The hair is brushed to the foreface. And then you cut the inner circle. The rim is being corrected. The eyes are cut free, two-thirds towards the corner of the eyes. Only with a visible eye, the Westie gets his typical and well-loved expression. Thank you. The line of the circle is cut with a thinning scissors. Has to look absolutely round. If the beard is too long, you get an oval-shaped head. In that case, the beard is brushed to the front and the curve gets corrected. Favorable brown hairs in the corners of the mouth are cut with ordinary scissors. An expressive, round-shaped head is a result of a well-done job. Behind the ears and on the occiput, all untidy and sticking out hairs have to be plucked out to get a neat and visible flow from head coat to neck coat. With a short-toothed stripping knife, you pluck the hair on the occiput over the head and the neck hair towards the dog's body. Be careful not to get mixed up with the hair of the ear rim while plucking the occiput, as you would end up plucking the entire ear, and from the front your Westie would look as if he had a hole under the ear. Behind the ears, no hairs should hang down, as this makes the neck look too short. Here you can see how the leash shows off the beginning of the head. With a correctly trimmed head, the leash is not hidden beneath the hair when you look at it from behind. Details can be worked over with the thinning scissors. Next to a beautiful head coat, the thick belly coat is the adornment of a well-groomed and well-presented Westie. Long, untidy and standing out belly hair is plucked carefully. Westies with only little belly hair need special and gentle treatment. You cut the belly coat along the contours of the rib cage. The result of the trimming should be a Westie with clear and flowing contours. Yet he should appear natural and not overstyled. Let's remember now how our Westie looked like an hour and a half ago. Such a result is definitely worth the effort, don't you think? A well-groomed dog should also have immaculate teeth. At least once a year, tartar has to be removed to avoid any inflammation of the gums, which causes bad breath and to reduce the risk of premature tooth loss. For a sensible tooth hygiene, you need the following equipment: a wing-shaped tartar remover, a bill-shaped tartar remover, a toothbrush for dogs, if needed, a fingerstyle with a rubber brush to massage the gums, dog toothpaste. For the tooth surface, you use a wing-shaped tartar remover. It is placed above the tartar rim, which means pushing the tartar remover very carefully under the gums. You scratch off the tartar using light pressure against the tooth. You can also use your fingernail if the tartar is not too thick. If there is a very thick layer of tartar, you can increase the pressure of your thumb. By this, the blade is fixed and you avoid it slipping into the wrong direction. Or other tiny objects from between the teeth, you should use the bill-shaped remover. Brushing your dog's teeth once or twice a week can minimize the growth of tartar. But in most cases, you cannot prevent it completely. You do not actually need a special dog toothbrush, as is shown, but you have to use a special toothpaste for dogs at all times. You can also use a special fingerstyle with rubber points that massages the gums simultaneously. At the end, a complete set of teeth is shown. It contains 42 teeth. Here you see the correct scissor bite of a Westie. 6 front teeth, called incisor teeth, lie between the 2 eye teeth, called canine teeth. You count from the front to the back. 1, 2, 3. 1, 2, 3. 3. The same goes for the lower jaw. 1, 2, 3. In the upper jaw, there are 6 molars behind the canine tooth on each side. 4 premolars and 2 molars. You count like this. Premolar 1, 2, 3, and relatively large P4. Behind it, the covert molars. In the lower jaw, the dog has 7 molars on each side. 4 premolars and 3 molars, of which only the first molar, M1, is visible. You count 1, 2, 3, 4. M1, M2 and M3 are covered.